This is a top secret, which I'm going to tell you now, but about 10 days ago, he had a talk in Simba. Simba, this is not a person from Lion King. This is a seminar in Barcelona. And the talk was so nice that I decided to invite him to give a similar talk at our seminar. So please. Well, you share the screen.
Yeah, of course. Can you see it?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So thank you very much. And thank you for the invitation. As you know, I have attended this seminar several times now, and I find it very, very interesting. So it's a real pleasure for me to be here today sharing some of my research with you. Okay, I'm going to talk about identities in primary. At the first part of the talk, I'm going to show you how some special identities are usually simplified in prime rings. The usual method is not systematic because it presents us with many different possibilities, and then we have to be smart in order to make the right choices. And in the end, this makes the proofs difficult somehow and does not give the best possible results. This we are going to see in detail. And then in the second part, I'm going to explain a new method for simplifying identities in prime rings, which is completely systematic and is based on translating the problem from prime rings to polynomial rings. I have to ask you to follow closely my point there, because I'm going to keep jumping and pinpointing many formulas and things. Okay? So let me start by introducing you to prime rings. Many of you may know this, but I'm going to try to make it with a fresh viewpoint. Okay, so prime rings are the non-commutative analog of integral domains. As you all very well know, a commutative unital ring is an integral domain if the product of two elements being zero forces one of them to be zero. Now, in the non-commutative case, we replace the elements by ideals. So a ring is prime if the product of two ideals being zero forces one of them to be zero. Examples of non-commutative prime rings are, for example, rings of metrics over fields, more in general any simple ring, and also the free associative algebras over fields in any number of variables. If you're not used to working with prime rings, don't worry, because you can just think that we are working with matrices over fields, and for this talk, this is enough. Prime rings happen to generalize some good properties of integral domains. For example, you know that an integral domain is embedded in its field of fractions, which is built by localization and is a field. In the same vein, any prime ring is embedded in its ring of quotients with a similar construction, more difficult, more complex, but similar. And then, since the prime ring is not commutative, the ring of quotients cannot be a field. It is not even a division ring, but its center is a field. Its center is called the center, the extended centroid of the prime ring, and is denoted here by capital C. Observe that the characteristic of a prime ring must be equal to the characteristic of its extended center, which is a field. So the characteristic of a prime ring must be either zero or a prime. Okay, when considering identities in prime rings, the concept of the ring of quotients is very, very important. But today, for this talk, the only relevant concept is the extended center. Informally, or informally speaking, we see the elements of the extended centroid as scalars for the prime ring, in the sense that we are going to consider many linear combinations and polynomials whose coefficients come from the extended center. Technically speaking, a prime ring is not in general an algebra over its extended center, but we can always enlarge the ring to include the extended centroid like this, and this is also a prime ring, and then without loss of generality, we can consider that the center of the ring is the extended center. So we are going to do this for this talk, and so for us, the center of a prime ring is going to be a field. I also need to introduce you to a technical tool called the multiplication algebra. This is important for us because it is the key tool translating the problem from prime rings to polynomial rings. Given an element of the ring, we can naturally define two linear maps, the left multiplication by the element and the right multiplication by the element. Now, we can consider these left and right multiplications for all the elements of the ring, and we can also compose them. When we do all this, we are building the multiplication algebra of the ring. In the case that the ring is prime, then the multiplication algebra is isomorphic as an algebra to the tensor product of the ring with its opposite ring. This property is important. Okay, after these preliminaries, we're ready to start talking about identities in prime rings. We could say that integral domains are so well behaved because whenever we have an identity of this kind, in which two expressions multiply to zero, then we can simplify it by saying that one of those expressions must be zero. In contrast, prime rings are not defined by elements, but by ideals. But couldn't we find some characterization of prime rings by elements? Yes, there is one. It happens that a ring is prime if the product of two elements cornered in the ring being zero forces one of the elements to be zero. This is really easy to check, and you can just do it as an exercise in two lines. And in terms of identities, this means that when we have an identity like this one, in which we have a variable cornered by two fixed expressions, then we can simplify it in a prime ring by saying that one of those expressions must be zero. Note two things here. First, I'm calling x a variable, but actually this identity must be true for all elements of the ring. And secondly, this identity is simple in some way. It has just one monomial, so to speak. We could consider more complex identities. For example, we could consider identities with more than one variable. It is easy to show also that we have a generalization of the characterization by elements. If the ring is prime, then if the product of three elements cornering the ring twice is zero, then this forces one of the elements to be zero. This is really easy to show. We consider the corner generated by B and C, and if it is zero, then by the characterization by elements, one of B or C must be zero. And if this is not the case, then there must be an element D here so that BDC is not zero. And now the corner of A and BDC forces A to be zero. In terms of identities, what we have here is that when we have an identity like this one in prime rings, in which we have several different variables sandwiched by fixed expressions, then we can simplify it by saying that one of those expressions must be zero. Okay, and what about identities with more than one monomial, with more than one term, like this here, for example, having two terms? Can we simplify them in prime rings? Surprisingly, the answer is also yes. If this element B here is not zero, then it turns out that this left element A must be a scalar multiple of this element C. So there is some scalar lambda in the extended centroid such that A equals lambda C. And more in general, we have a similar result for any number of terms. The celebrated Martindale's lemma says that in a prime ring, if we have an identity of this kind, in which we have a linear combination of terms, all with the same variable in the middle, and this is important, then looking at one of them, if this element B is not zero, then the element A must be a linear combination of all the other left elements. Martindale's lemma is very important for this first part of the talk because it implements the usual method for simplifying identities in prime rings. What it is basically saying is that whenever we have an identity of this kind, we can simplify it to an identity involving only its left expressions. But today, the identities that interest us are of a special kind. They are like this. They are linear combinations over the extended centroid of terms with the same variable in the middle, cornered by some powers of the same element A at the left and right. So you see that we can apply Martindale's lemma to this kind of identity, and it says that either this element here is zero, so A will be nilpotent, and in particular algebraic, or this power here must be a linear combination of the other left powers, and so it must be algebraic. So in any case, the element A is algebraic, and so it must have a minimal polynomial. But actually, different minimal polynomials can give rise to the same identity. And Martindale's lemma is going to help us in finding all those possible minimal polynomials from a fixed identity. But before we embark on this quest of finding minimal polynomials, let me digress a little bit, because you can be thinking right now, okay, why do we care about this special kind of identity? And the answer is because it appears in Herstein theory, which is the study of the non-associative structures arising from associative rings. And so you can see that this is important in particular for non-associative algebra. Let me give you some examples of Herstein theory. Given an associative ring, we can define a new product, the bracket product, xy minus yx, and then the associative ring equipped with this bracket product becomes a Lie ring. This Lie ring has some interesting ideas. For example, the center of the ring is now a Lie ideal, and the derived subalgebra in brackets is also a Lie ideal. Similarly, we can define the circle product as y plus yx, and then the ring becomes, with this new product, a Jordan ring. Herstein showed that whenever the starting the original associative ring is simple, then some associative Jordan and Lie rings are also simple. And this is important in the classification of non-associative algebras. In particular, Herstein theory is important in the classification of Lie and Jordan algebras. Why? Because we can translate the problem to associative rings. For example, we know that any Lie algebra over a field is a Lie algebra of some associative algebra equipped with the bracket product through its universal enveloping algebra and the Poincaré-Birkhoff-Witt theorem. And in Jordan algebras, we have the celebrated Zermanos theorem classifying the strongly prime Jordan algebras, even in infinite dimension. And so, almost all strongly prime Jordan algebras are subalgebras of some associative ring equipped with the circle product, except for some family of finite dimension, of 27 dimensions. This theorem happens to answer an important question in quantum theory. I hope now you are motivated about these identities. And so I'm going to give you the first example of simplifying an identity in a prime ring through Martindale's lemma. This example comes from Herstein theory. So this is an actual example coming from research. Given an element A of the ring, through its bracket product, we can define a linear map called the adjoint map. And we can compose this adjoint map with itself. Then an element is called a nilpotent of index at most n if the adjoint map of the element composed with itself n times sends the whole ring to zero. For example, an nilpotent element of index at most one is just an element commuting with the whole ring. So it's just an element of the center. And an nilpotent element of index at most two satisfies A times A times R being zero in brackets. When we expand this identity, we get this. And look here, we have a linear combination of terms all with the same variable in the middle, cornered by some powers of the same type. So this is an identity of our special kind. So by Martindale's lemma, we know that the element A is algebraic, and so it must have some possible minimal polynomials. So let's try to find them through Martindale's lemma. First, we're going to take the identity and do some manipulations. I'm going to take these two and put it through this X here. And I'm going to note that here and here we have ones. We have ones here and here. So now we have this identity. And we put our Martindale's glasses on to use Martindale's lemma and see and say, okay, here we have one, which is not zero. So this left power here must be a linear combination of this A and this one. So there are scalars lambda mu in the standard centroid such that A squares equals lambda A plus mu. In particular, A is algebraic of degree at most 2. But we would like to find the possible minimal polynomial. So we would like to know the possible values for lambda mu. This we are going to do by substituting this expression in the original identity to reduce its degree and then applying Martindale's lemma. So we take lambda A plus mu and substitute it for A squared. We get this identity here and we reorder it in order to have as few terms as possible. And so now we put our Martindale's glasses on again to apply Martindale's lemma, but now we find some problem. Here are the choices I was talking about before. Now we could use Martindale's lemma here in this term or in the other term, and it is not clear which one is better. We could say, okay, here we have a one, so this expression here must be a scalar multiple of this one. But this is not the best way to proceed. Actually, it's better to say, to apply Martindale's lemma at this term and say, okay, either this expression is zero or A must be a scalar multiple of this one. So in that case, A will be an element of the extended centroid and we are finished because we have the minimal polynomial here. On the other hand, if lambda minus 2A equals zero, then lambda equals 2A and we have another problem because we have to separate in two cases. Now here, the characteristic of the ring appears and it happens that if the characteristic of the ring is 2, then this lambda is 0. So A squared equals mu, which is an element of the extended centroid, and we can read the minimal polynomial from here. On the other hand, if the characteristic of the ring is not 2, then since the extended centroid is a field, we can divide by 2 here to get that A equals half lambda, which is an element of the extended centroid, and we are finished. So summarizing, you see, we have different possibilities. We have many cases already for this little identity. And in the end, either the element A is in the standard centroid or the element squared is in the standard centroid. And this can only happen when we have characteristics 2. So an omnipotent element of index at most 2 can have these two minimal polynomials, S minus lambda, and in the case of characteristic 2, it may have X squared minus lambda. A priori, we could apply this method for any omnipotent element of any order. But as n increases, the application of Martindale's lemma gets more and more cumbersome because we get more possibilities. And in the end, we need to find the right ones, right? But if we are smart enough, we can actually prove through Martindale's lemma this theorem by Martindale and Mears, which says that in a prime ring, the omnipotent elements of order exactly n can only have this minimal polynomial when we restrict to the cases of good characteristics. So here, because we are using Martindale's lemma, we need to restrict to good characteristics and order exactly n. These are two exclusions that we don't want. This happens because Martindale's lemma is not systematic. When we introduce our new method, which is systematic, we are going to remove these exclusions and give a new version of this theorem. Okay, summarizing until now, we have identities of a special kind, like this one. We know that then the element A is algebraic, and we want to find all the possible minimal polynomials giving rise to this kind of identity. And we don't want to do this through Martindale's lemma, but we want a systematic method. This method we're going to find by transforming the problem from prime rings to rings of polynomials in two variables. And then we are going to use elementary algebraic geometry to solve the polynomial problem. This we are going to achieve through the multiplication algebra. So let me refresh you the multiplication algebra again. This is just a duplicate of the previous slide. Given an element, we have the left and right multiplications by the element, which are linear maps, and we can take all the linear, all the left and right multiplications, compose them to get the multiplication algebra of the ring. And then the multiplication algebra is isomorphic to the tensor product of the ring with its opposite. With this, we can start transforming our problem to a polynomial problem. Look closely here at the left-hand side of our identity. we can see that each term is an image of an element of the multiplication algebra. Look, we know that AX is just the application of the lemma multiplication by A to X. And similarly, XY, XA is just the right multiplication by A. Now, A squared X is just the left multiplication by A applied twice. AXA is just the composition of the left and right multiplications, and so on and so forth. So in the end, our left-hand side is just the image of some linear map in the multiplication algebra. And this linear map has the structure of a polynomial in the following sense. It is a linear combination over the extended centroid of powers of the left and right multiplication. So there is a polynomial f in two variables over the extended centroid such that our linear map is just the evaluation of the polynomial f in the left and right multiplication. Let us say, so we have right from an identity to a polynomial in two variables. And the translation is easy to make. If we consider one fixed term, then we only need to put the powers of A appearing at the left as powers of X, and the powers appearing at the right as powers of Y. So here, for example, we have A squared at the left. So we get X squared. And we have A squared at the right here. So here we get Y squared. And here we have A and A at the left and right. So we get X times Y. And that's all. That's how we get our polynomial. And now it's obvious that the following claims are equivalent. We have this identity in our ring. Its associated linear map sends the ring to zero. And the associated linear map is the zero element inside the multiplication algebra. But now observe that we are not using the full multiplication algebra of the full ring. We are only considering one element A, only its left and right multiplication. So we are working inside the subalgebra generated by the left and right multiplication by A. We're calling this subalgebra the multiplication algebra of the element. And now we can see that our identity is true in our prime ring if and only if its associated linear map is the zero element inside the multiplication algebra of the element, because this element belongs to the subalgebra. This is the condition we're working with. And the important fact here is that the same isomorphisms making the multiplication algebra of the ring a tensor product of the ring also makes the multiplication algebra of the element a tensor product of the subalgebra generated by the element inside the ring. And this object we can control. How? Well, if the element A is algebraic with minimal polynomial P, then we know that the subalgebra it generates inside the ring is isomorphic to the polynomial ring in one variable modulo the ideal generated by the polynomial P. And now we know that the multiplication algebra of the element is isomorphic to this tensor product. But the opposite ring of this algebra is the same algebra, because the element we have the subalgebra generated by only one element, and so this is commutative. So here we have the tensor product of two quotients of rings of polynomials. And this is well known to be a new quotient of a polynomial ring in two variables, modulo in this case, by the ideal generated by PS, P1. So what we have shown is that in a prime ring, if an element is algebraic, then its multiplication algebra is just the quotient of a polynomial ring in two variables. And finally, with this, we have completely translated our problem from prime rings to polynomial rings. Now we know that if an element A is algebraic with minimal polynomial P, then A is going to satisfy the identity associated to the polynomial F in two variables, if and only if the polynomial F belongs to the ideal generated by PS P1. This is a polynomial problem. So now our problem is, given a fixed polynomial F in two variables, which are the possible polynomials P in one variable such that F belongs to the ideal generated by PS P1? This is a kind of inverse ideal membership problem. This condition is the same as saying that F is a combination of PX, PY with polynomials in two variables as coefficients. And already from this condition, we can make some easy observations. For example, if Q divides P and F belongs to the ideal generated by PSPY, then we know that F must also belong to the ideal generated by QSQY. So we only need to determine the maximal P. And also, it's clear that PSPY is a Gronner basis for the ideal generated by PSPY. So F is going to belong to this ideal if and only if its division by PSPY gives zero remainder. This is just the main property of Gronner basis. And this is important for the proof of our main theorem. But we are not going to see such proof, okay? So how can we, given some F in two variables, how can we determine all the possible polynomials P in one variable satisfying this condition? The answer is through roots. A polynomial in one variable is completely determined by its roots in some algebraic closure of the underlying field. And observe that if we evaluate here some root of P, then this term cancels. And if we put here some other root of P, then this term also cancels, giving zero. And so we have shown that any pair, a pair of roots of P must be a zero of F. So if we're considering some set of potential roots for some possible minimal polynomials, then we know that all their combination by pairs must give zeros of F. And moreover, if we replace this Y by X, then we see that this expression is a multiple of PX. So PX divides the polynomial in one variable, F of XX. And so in particular, the roots of P are found among the roots of F of X. So here we have some procedure to find the possible roots for the minimal polynomials. First, we determine the roots of F of XX, and then we look at the sets and see which of them give zeros of F in all their possible combinations by pairs. But we have a problem with this procedure. We are lacking the multiplicity of the roots. And observe that different sets of multiplicities could give rise to different minimal polynomials. To find those multiplicities, we're going to generalize an idea from the theory of polynomials in one variable. We know that an element is a root of a polynomial in one variable of multiplicity k, if and only if it is also a root of all its derivatives up to order k. And to generalize this to two variables, we're going to use the Taylor expansion of the polynomial in two variables. We know that this expansion has as coefficients the partial derivatives divided by some factors. But recall that we want to solve the problem for all fields. So we have to consider fields with prime characteristics. And in prime characteristics, we cannot divide by an arbitrary integer. So we cannot use this. Instead, we're going to use the hash derivatives. The hash derivatives are similar to the usual partial derivatives, but instead of having the divided factorial here, they put it here inside the derivative. So that now when we derive a power of x, we have here a binomial coefficient. And the divided factorial is here inside this binomial coefficient. So now we don't have any actual division. For the rest, the hash derivatives are very similar to the usual one. The only thing you need to know is this. When we derive with respect to x, I times the nth power of x, we reduce the exponent as always, but now as coefficient, we get this binomial number. This is all you need to know. The rest is the same. And now the Taylor expansion of a polynomial in two variables with the hash derivatives just has the hash derivatives as coefficients. We have no divisions whatsoever. And we have solved the problem for the characteristic. Now with all this information, we are ready to understand the main theorem of this talk, solving the polynomial problem. If we know a polynomial in one variable, meaning that we know its roots with multiplicities, then we know that the polynomial f in two variables belongs to the ideal generated by PSPY, if and only if all the pairs of roots of the polynomial are zeros, not only of f, as we saw before, but also of all it has derivatives of orders up to the corresponding multiplicities of the roots. So taking one particular pair, it must be a zero of all the derivatives up to order the multiplicity of the left root in X and the multiplicity of the right root in Y. This condition may look a little bit difficult to grasp right now for you, but it gives rise to a nice algorithm to solve the original problem. The algorithm is like this. First, we determine all the roots of f of xx. From those roots, we have to determine the possible sets of roots for the minimal polynomials. A set is going to be a valid set of roots if and only the points of the rectangular grid it generates in a two-dimensional grid, in a two-dimensional space, are zeros, are all zeros of the polynomial f. And then we need to find the multiplicities of the roots, and this we do through the hash derivatives. Here I have put a table summarizing the smallest cases. Here we have the possible minimal polynomials, only with roots 0 and 1, and up to multiplicity. Here we have the grid degenerate, so 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. And in the entries of the table, we have which derivatives must annihilate in which points of the grid. So for example, if we just want 0 with multiplicity 1, then we just need the polynomial to go through 0, 0, and we don't have any conditions on the other parts of the grid. Now we want 0 with multiplicity 2, then we need all the derivatives of 2xy in 0, 0. If we want 0 and 1 with multiplicity 1, then we need the polynomial to go through all the points in the grid, but since we don't have any multiplicity bigger than 1, we don't need any condition on the derivatives. If we now want 0 with multiplicity 2 and 1 with multiplicity 1, then in 0, 0, we need all derivatives up to sy. Here in 0, 1, since we have 0 at the left, we need dx. Here in 1, 0, we have 0 at the right, so we need dy. And here in 1, 1, we don't have zeros, so we don't need any derivatives. And lastly, if we want 0 and 1 with multiplicity 2, then we are going to need all derivatives up to sy going through all the points in the grid. Now I'm going to show you how to use this new systematic method. Recall that when we had an unipotent element, it was algebraic, and a theorem by Martindale and Mears gave us its possible minimal polynomial, but with two exclusions. Now we're going to remove those exclusions and give a new version of the theorem, as I said before. Well, what before was a rather difficult problem, perhaps, now it's quite simple because the polynomial in two variables associated to this identity is quite simple. It's just x minus y to the power of n. Then we're going to apply our algorithm. As you know, first we need to determine the roots of f of x. When we replace y by x here, we just get zero. So this means that any scalar can be a root for a minimal polynomial. But a minimal polynomial cannot have two different roots. Why? Because if we evaluate two different roots here, we can never get zero. And this is the condition. So the possible minimal polynomials are of this kind. Any possible root with some multiplicity and only one root. And now to determine the multiplicity, as you know, we are going to compute the hash derivatives and evaluate in lambda. Okay, let's do this. We're going to derive this. When we derive with respect to x I times, we reduce the exponent here, and we get this binomial coefficient. And when we derive later by y j times, we reduce more the exponent and get another binomial coefficient. Observe that when we replace lambda and lambda here, sorry, having some problem with Dropbox. Now, can you see my screen? Can you see my slides?
Yes. Both.
Okay, perfect. Then I was saying that now we have to replace lambda and lambda here in the derivatives, and when we do so, because of this factor, this term cancels and we get zero, unless this exponent is zero, in which case we just get this binomial coefficient here, which may be zero or maybe not zero, depending on the characteristic of the ring. In the end, we get that many derivatives are zero and some of them are binomial coefficients. And with this information, we can get the new version of the Martindale and Mears theorem. Now in a prime ring, and an omnipotent element of index at most n, not exactly, but at most n, this element can only have these possible minimal polynomials, where now we have an extra factor in the exponent, which depends on how many of these binomial coefficients are divided by the characteristic of the ring. And in this way, we also remove the characteristic residue. And so you see that with the systematic method, we can get complete results. I'm going to show you now another example, just to show you that this method can be made geometric. We can solve the original problem with plots, with two-dimensional plots. Now we're going to consider that the underlying field is the real numbers. We're going to consider some identity. It doesn't matter which one, because the method is systematic. And then it has some polynomial in two variables associated, and we can get the roots associated to this polynomial. And then what we do is to make a plot in which we plot the curve of zeros of the associated polynomial in two variables and look at which rectangular grid of points lie completely over the curve. In this case, we see that the grid generated by 0 and 1 lies completely over the curve of F. And this means that 0 and 1 can be together in a minimal polynomial for F. So what we need now is to determine the maximal possible multiplicities. And this we do by plotting the curves associated to the derivatives. We have to look at which curves go through which point in the derivatives, as in the table before. And with this information and the main theorem, we can deduce the maximal possible multiplicities. In this particular case, we can deduce that we can have 0 with multiplicity 2 and 1 with multiplicity 1. But we cannot have multiplicity 2 also in 1, because as we saw before in the table, in that case, we will need that all the derivatives go through all the points in the grid. And we see that this is not the case. So in the end, for an element satisfying this identity in a prime ring, we get these possible minimal polynomials. And this means, in the end, because not all of them are maximum, that either the element A is a very specific element in the center, or A cube must be equal to A squared. And in fact, if you apply this condition here, you're going to see that this gives 0. But this is the only way. Either this condition is satisfied, or the element is this element is the center. And you see that we have gotten this result with a systematic method. So to end this talk, let me tell you something about possible generalizations of this method, of these ideas. This is what I'm thinking about right now. For example, could we extend this method from prime rings to semi-prime rings? Semi-prime rings are just the non-commutative analog or reduced rings. Well, we have something. We still have that the multiplication algebra of the ring is isomorphic as an algebra to the tensor product of the ring with its opposite ring. So this is good news. But the bad news is that now the standing centroid is not a field. So this makes things more difficult. We could use perhaps that a semi-prime ring is a side-direct product of prime rings. I don't know if we could do, we could give similar results or not. I have not thought much about this yet, but I think this is interesting. We could also think about generalizing the method to identities of this kind, which have only one variable, but have different elements at the right and left, and perhaps with some non-trivial relations between the elements. Now the problem is that, okay, before we had the subalgebra generated by just one element, and so it was commutative, and this gave us polynomial rings. But now, when we have the subalgebra generated by more than one element, the subalgebra is not going to be commutative. So we cannot translate the problem to a problem in polynomials. We need to go to free associative algebras. And then we can use the result here, which says that the tensor product of two quotients of free associative algebras is also a quotient of a free associative algebra. But now we don't only need to consider the original ideals coming from the original quotients, but we also need to consider the ideal generated by some commutators of the generators. This is very easy to see when you think about it. And then in this context, for example, we can prove that Martindale's lemma is just an elementary consequence of this point of view. I think that we can do this generalization, and I'm positive that we can get the methods. We have to consider Gronner bases for the ideals and so on. And the last generalization we can consider is to consider more than one variable in our identities, like here. Informally, we could solve this iteratively. We could consider that X is constant and solve for Y, and later go back and solve for X. And technically, what we will be doing is to work with the multiplication algebra or the multiplication algebra of the ring, and so on. And this is not an actual problem, because when the ring is prime, then its multiplication algebra is also prime with the same extended centroid. So we could keep doing this and getting more and more variables in our identity. And so these have been my thoughts about this problem until now. And so with this, I'm finishing. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much for the interesting talk. Do you have any questions or comments? If you want to say something, simply unmute your microphone and you can start to speak.
I can boast I spotted Birkhoff's theorem at one point.
Yes.
Good. So I've been a careful listener.
Yeah.
Not an algebraic, an expert in algebra.
Yeah, but do you have some question or?
So you have a question or you have a comment?
I just bragged. I'm a conscientious student.
Okay. I see. That's nice. Thank you.
Some other questions or comments? If no, thank you very much for the participation and for the speaker. Samuel, you want to say something?
No, I was just congratulating Joseph for a very nice talk.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
By the way, on Monday, there will be a seminar on group algebras in Budapest. I sent a message, I'm not sure for all of us or for some of them, because we have agreement, our seminar with the seminar in Budapest, to exchange information. Also, the next Friday, in the same time, in Sofia, we have a talk which is on mathematical logic. The title is, you can see it, but this is by Christo Ganchev from the university, Enumeration Reducibility, 60 Years of Investigation. And on the homepage of the seminar, of course, we announce the talk till the end of March. And if some of you wants to give a talk, you should contact me. Or Dmitry Gelev or Elitsa Christova.
Yeah, I would very much recommend the talk on enumeration reducibilities. It's a closely related notion to celebrated Turing reducibility, the reducibility of one assumedly algorithmically undecidable problem to another one. So problems which are of the same complexity with respect to their algorithmic solvability form classes, and these classes form an algebraic structure. Yeah, and there are problems related to that, and this has been studied in the School of Logic, mostly at Sofia University, for I think now three generations. Yes, ever since the times of Rogers and Schoenfield and others. And it would be a rich talk in history wise. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. If no more, yeah, thank you for the participation.
And, thank you.
Okay, bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Was the time okay?
Yeah, it was okay.